morning. I hope you are not tired of seeing me in CMR very often. One of the saving graces is that I don't speak on the same topic every time I come. Something or other is different. And going with today's theme, which is about contemporary constitutional practice, I thought I will speak on the concept of the vulnerable. Who is the vulnerable? Whom do we identify as the vulnerable? So the construct of vulnerable, which is emerging in the global context, and the way in which this vulnerable has been addressed by Indian constitution is going to be the theme of my presentation. Now, whenever we talk about the vulnerable, we tend to talk about protecting the vulnerable. But the need is to not only protect but also include the vulnerable. The need is to not only look at the vulnerable as an object of law, but to treat that vulnerable having a voice in the formation of the law and providing that vulnerable to voice their needs, how much ever they are capable of voicing. When I give the example, it will be very clear to you. In fact, I prepared this presentation initially the very construct of vulnerable for our research ethics committee. Because at the university level, when you are researching across seven, we now have eight faculties, the very idea of the vulnerable is not at all known to them. For example, one of my PhD students is working on child soldiers in the virtual area, a girl child soldiers. So we all think child soldier issue is only African issue, it is only the issue which has been taken up by International Criminal Court. But the reality is that we have got child soldiers in our neighbor itself, and girl child soldiers at a very young age being recruited into the non-state forces, and state also recruiting these girl children to tackle those girl soldiers or child soldiers in those unethical or illegal armed forces. So both are at fault. It's not just that only those forces are using these girl child soldiers or child soldiers. So child soldier issue, when we were researching, we realized that it is a child. So when you are using them as a source of your data, when you are making a research about them, are we to treat them as if they are the data which is there in the book? Or when you are treating a human subject as the subject of research, how do you go about it? So this is how I went into the area of looking at the vulnerable as a research subject. But my personal engagement with the vulnerability has been manifold, because we did not look at the phrase vulnerable. But I always had passion for researching about those who did not have voice in the legal system, those whose needs were not met by the legal system. If you look at India's Legal Services Authority Act, the legal aid, who are eligible to get legal aid, you see the eligibility criteria, that is nothing but vulnerable. So 86% of Indian population is covered by the Legal Aid Services Act. Unfortunately, we do not have that number of lawyers to address these unmet legal needs. Therefore, we see only 10% of the legal needs of the community figuring in the court of law. Isn't that a travesty of justice? If you go by the access to justice, if you go by the right to legal aid within the constitutional scheme. The other dimension is because the vulnerable are either voiceless or they are not able to participate in the mainstream, automatically the other facets of justice, other than the political justice, the economic and the social justice, also become a mirage for them. So this is the reality of constitutional scheme of justice in relation to the vulnerable, constitutional scheme of rights in relation to the vulnerable, which need to be seen. So that begs the first question, who is the vulnerable? How do we define the vulnerable? Where do we find this definition? There is no legislation which defines the vulnerable, but there is plenty of juristic writing, research writing, which has addressed the idea of the vulnerable in different contexts. So vulnerable are the ones who potentially lack capacity. By capacity, we mean, go back to someone's jurisprudence, diocese jurisprudence. What is capacity? Capacity is the ability to influence one's own situation and alter others' situation. So potentially lacking capacity means not only in actuality they are not having capacity, but inherently they may not have the capacity. For example, if you look at the case of the older person, the person may have had the capacity when they were younger, but the transition into the aging might have made them might have made them the older person, and then the frail older person. Within the older class, we afraid older class. Go back to the reasonable classification concept. So, class within the class sometimes can be vulnerable. Secondly, prepared capacity, where the person had the capacity. See, in case of frail old age, capacity is lost or diminished. In case of a trauma survivor, for example, now this trauma need not necessarily be accident alone. Do you know that there are inherent brain fits that people go through? Overnight people change their behavior, overnight people change. If you watch these films about lobotomy and things like that, you would understand what I'm talking about. Trauma could also be because of separation, because of transition, because of displacement. So, trauma survivors also have impaired capacity, so they are vulnerable. Then, vulnerability can be broadly defined as a situation which is arising out of resource deprivation or resource lacking. It could be, I mean, what are the resources? Poverty is one of the situations of multiple resources being affected. Location. Vulnerability can come from location. Imagine Vijay Mallya in the UK and Vijay Mallya in India. Once upon a time he was vulnerable in the UK, today he is vulnerable in India. So, location specific, I mean that's a very popular example, but if you want a very serious example, we can talk about the migrants. They have a location disadvantage. For example, in my home district, which is coastal Karnataka, quite a rich district, people have got the money to call the umbrellas. So, Northern Karnataka people from the Hyderabad, Karnataka and Maharashtra, Karnataka, they migrate over our part of the state in coastal Karnataka, and they become vulnerable to many kinds of things. Like when I was teaching in Manipal, I came to know about this family from Bijapur which was staying in a tent, and Manipal has got a huge forest cover. And the child was kept in the tent, and then the mother went out to fetch water. You can't think of them having taps, etc. So by the time she came back, a python had woken the child. So this is vulnerability, physical vulnerability. So location, it comes. I mean, would she be imagining that vulnerability if she was living in Bijapur? She wouldn't have. So there is an impaired capacity that she has got because of her ignorance and the location that she has migrated. Just imagine it in case of migrants who are denied of citizenship or migrants who are denied of social cultural participation in the local community or as ghettoized, as treated as the other. So think of all those social and cultural dimensions and look at the fundamental rights and look at their rights as citizens. Vulnerability can occur over time. Age is one issue. Passage of the law is another issue. So, vulnerability can be possible in that. Then, vulnerability is about lack of power or participation on equal footing with the rest of the state or rest of the community because of their power position. So, your socio-economic or socio-cultural standpoint, in feminism we talk about standpointism. So, where you stand can lead to a lot of difference. In culture also, your standpointism makes a lot of difference. So, vulnerability is about that. So, vulnerability may include both adults and children. This is the thesis. Go back to the constitution. Make special provisions for women and children. So, I am going to end this lecture by saying that make special provision for women, children and the vulnerable. Why do I say and the vulnerable? Women and children per se may be within the vulnerable category, but then sometimes their vulnerability may be compounded in many other criteria. Imagine a woman who is old age and frail, who is deprived of her right to access to property or economic means, who doesn't have social security. So she is rendered vulnerable not only by her culture, by her gender, but also because of the absence of state's specific action to address such vulnerability. So from that point of view, if you see, the category called vulnerable is the most important category that the constitution and the justice scheme need to address. That's my argument. So, irrespective of legal age, children may be vulnerable. So legal age is 18 years for some purposes, contractual purposes. Legal age is 14 in some cultures for marriage purposes. Legal age is 60, once again, for age of consent to have sex. So this is how there is a very landscape, even though Law Commission of India gave a recommendation to make a uniform age of consent. The danger that was lurking in this kind of implementation was what the judges expressed to me many times. that if you declare only 16 as the age of valid consent for marriage, what about those 54% of marriages in India which are courted before 16th year and the children born out of that become illegitimate? So what happens to their right to inheritance and succession? So this is where we have the challenge. The need of care and support from risk of abuse or neglect, or who are unable to do so on their own, these are also called vulnerable. So do you get the conceptualization of vulnerability on the whole? Now, vulnerable are those segments of the population who are at the risk of abuse or at neglect, or who are not able to protect themselves, who may experience harm or distress than the majority of the population in a given situation or location. So we can take the example of those who are subject to, or who are having brain or mind impairment, dementia occurs with the age as well. Learning disability, they are vulnerable. Any form of disability is vulnerable, but learning disability is also a variety of vulnerability. Mental health patients, pre-older people, asylum seekers, the homeless, traveling community, migrants. The traveling community is one of the varieties, but the traveling community is the indigenous community in many countries of different variety. Even in Europe, we have the Roma population. So it is in the Roma population related judgment that European Court of Human Rights elaborated on the idea of a vulnerability. And then we have bereaved or victims of abuse. Bereaved, those who lose their parents, those who lose their spouses, they are vulnerable as well because they are in the mental state of shock. So there is impairment of their capacity to think. That is why I am again emphasizing it's about power, it's about trauma, which renders your capacity diminished. It's about resources, that you may not be able to fetch the resource which the majority of the community may fetch. Drug users, I call them vulnerable, because under the influence of the drug you could become vulnerable to violence, or you could become vulnerable to be used for violence. Then we have family carers who are vulnerable as well, those who go to give care to the family, lot of migrant workers from India, women workers particularly went to give care to babies and elderly in the Middle East and other places, and they became vulnerable. Sometimes they became vulnerable to abuses or snatching of their passport, left in the lurch. So all these cases. So one of the foremost thinkers in the area of vulnerability was Martha Feynman. Martha Feynman was homeland of Coca-Cola. She's from that place in the United States of America, which offered the chair which she was sponsoring on vulnerability studies. She's a feminist jurist, and Martha Feynman says that vulnerability so far has been body specific. It has been defined in the form of somebody's body, whether as age or gender or as somebody's location or nationality. But she says that we have to conceptualize vulnerability beyond the body. We have to conceptualize it. By that she means compounded cases of mental incapacity, compounded cases of socio-cultural incapacity created in the person. For example, think of a girl child and a boy child brought up in the same environment, and then compare them with the girl child and the boy child who are brought up in an environment of discrimination or exclusion or denial. Do you think there is vulnerability? Definitely. Because the person grows up with a worldview which makes the person think that denial is not wrong, violation is not wrong. Your brother getting the best food, you not getting the best food is not wrong, because that's your entitlement. So Martha Feynman points out to this non-body specific situations of vulnerability or factors of vulnerability. So she says that there's a need for going in a broader definition about vulnerability. European Court of Human Rights, while referring to the Gypsy and the Roma population and the rights related to them, particularly their right of identity, particularly the way in which they brought up their children, not to be compared, not to be despised, them not to be excluded from the schools and opportunities, in our constitution, equal access, equal opportunities. So access and opportunity, accommodation, so these points were highlighted by looking at the human rights of the Roma population in the European Court of Human Rights. I can only give you the glimpses of this because we have limited time. So now, in the light of this understanding of vulnerability, let's go to the constitutional scheme. An elaborate scheme of the constitution is present without mentioning the word vulnerable in Indian context. But that scheme is still inadequate because it was conceived at a time when the knowledge of vulnerability was very limited. Current knowledge of vulnerability comes from the sociological studies, it comes from the political science studies, it comes from the medical sciences, mental health science, psychiatry and things like that. So aside from our legal studies and judgments and things like that. So let me show you a video which will tell you why vulnerability as a theme requires constitutional consideration. I call it as the law genome. This law genome concept is set in the context of human genome studies.
Such thing as like a pure race. in a way, we're all kind of cousins, in a broad sense, in a much more direct sense. You know, a cousin in this room.
Civil and political rights, economic, social and cultural rights. So that is how we saw the exponential development of our 3 Article 21 and gradual realization of Article 21 being the topmost in the scheme of hierarchy of fundamental rights, as Professor Khan calls. Then he speaks about how development related rights came about, human right to development. So most of the dimensions, whether it is in relation to indigenous people's rights or in relation to women's rights, they were more in the context of our environmental rights. They came in the context of development, because country had to progress further in infrastructure development, in providing for resources, big dam kind of cases, you know, Ramallah Tower case, etc. So the judiciary had to always juggle these international constitutional dimensions to the Indian reality. However, lately we have seen sustainable development goals occupying the center stage in international law. Sustainable development goals, I think there are 12, 18 goals. In these goals, most important goals include equality clauses, they include access to justice as one of the important dimensions, and poverty elimination, not just reduction but elimination, gender equality as one of the most important dimensions. So if you look at that and see the working of the constitution, vulnerable is the link, is the link between all of them. So sustainable development goals are supposed to be addressing the biggest trauma of this millennium, which is huge gap between the rich and the poor, and the money being or capital and resources. I told you vulnerability arises out of resources, as Martha Feynman said. So if the resources are concentrated, 80% of the resources are concentrated in 9% of the population of the world, what happens to the 91% population of the world to fiddle with only small percentage of resources? And today if you look at Jeff Bezos' personal wealth or corporate wealth, and the way he is not a philanthropist like Bill Gates or what is the other guy, the Walmart guy. So you can imagine the kind of havoc that it wreaks and renders a larger percentage of population as the vulnerable to be controlled and not to be experiencing the freedom that he is experiencing, or equality that he is experiencing, or justice that he is experiencing, to take a case in. So sustainable development goals address to this, and a lot of rich pledged to giving up their wealth and things like that as a byproduct of such sustainable development goal declaration. But there's a lot of proactive work that needs to be done in case of every nation and within the constitutional scheme to regulate this wealth, to translate this wealth, to distribute this wealth through the agency of the state. So, Professor Chimney, in his article on third world approaches to international law, 12 approaches to international law, he talks about human rights in an unequal world. And that is about the world where there is a transnational capital class which is to be facing the transnational oppressed class. Who are the transnational oppressed class? The vulnerable, the migrants, those who do not have access to capital or who do not have reasonable exercise of use of capital or generation of capital. So the capacity to have those resources, not just financial resources, but also the intellectual ability, social opportunity, to generate those resources. So these resources can be, we always thought of resources as property in the tangible way, as land once upon a time. Then the idea of resources moved from land to water, then from water to machinery, then from machinery to silicon chips, and then we moved now to data, knowledge. So knowledge is also a form of resource. So the definition of resource, access to resource, capacity to control resource or generate resource, and the vulnerable. Just see the connection. Can you see the connection, all of you? Yeah. This is exactly where even today we don't have women in more than 11% of leadership in politics. We have reservations made, we have affirmative actions, but then the lack of resources in terms of development of the persona or social and political access makes people still slowly move out of such vulnerability to empowerment. So having connected sustainable development goal through the journey of the constitutional cases to this link of vulnerability. Let me take you through part 3 of the constitution, the provisions as well as the interpretation of these provisions through various case laws. The provisions have provided for proactive, facilitative and preventive role towards vulnerability. What is the proactive role? Making special provisions for women and children. Facilitative, again, these provisions plus provisions which are prohibiting any activity which creates vulnerability, like exploitative, Article 23. Preventive, punishing them, abolition of untouchability, for example. There are very severe punishments and actions on that. However, Martha Feynman's lament about physical dimension of vulnerability still seems to be dominating the discourse in the constitution. It has not gone into the deeper layers of vulnerability, whether in case laws or other things, except barring a few instances. So those instances were already narrated by Professor Uke, but I will add a little more dimensions to that. Let me take you through that. So the second segment in the constitution where such vulnerability is addressed is the idea of social security, the idea of providing for work or employability, employment, not employability. Employability is where we need to address vulnerability. So part 4, although non-justiciable, has got the aspiration of socio-economic and cultural rights where maximum cases of vulnerability sit. So part 4 has been incorporated or migrated into part 3 by the judicial innovation. So some of these judicial innovation are evident in landmark cases. One of the landmark cases has been, we know that Shaban case, although it may look like a personal law related case, it has got the deeper cultural dimension which is underlying it, where they spoke about 200 rupees a month kind of interim maintenance, Justice Chandrachur Senior said, is not enough to keep the body with the soul, means dignity. How economic vulnerability of a woman whose husband was well practicing earning lawyer. So vulnerability is not just about where you are born, it is not just about who you are married to, it is also about how you are treated. So the location and the time, the equation changes between husband and wife and she becomes vulnerable. So it's in one's own lifetime one can become vulnerable, based on the space and the, based on the time and the location. So that case was the one where you saw part 4 resonating with the part 3 and then being connected to criminal procedure code and making a way for uniform civil code directive by the court. We have had similar cases, a series of Sarlamutur case, Triple Tarak case, are all the cases where part 4 has been connected to part 3 addressing the specific vulnerability issues of women. Then there we have moved more into physical dimension because of the gender involved there and the cultural treatment of that gender based on the religion and deprivation of the right, depriving the capacity, limiting the resource. Going back to our first slide, the definition of vulnerability. Does it make sense to you? So I'm trying to bring you a concept in the constitutional context, which very little about which very little has been written. That's why I want you to focus more on this. Now coming to enlarging Article 21 in this context, from the context of vulnerability, we have seen that Article 21 has been enlarged in various cases. One case has been right to education, which has made its headway into making an act. Right to information, which is part of the right to know under Article 19.1A. Under right to information, so right to freedom of speech and expression and right to know as a facet of freedom of speech and expression. So that has again to do with the quality of life. And then we have health, we know that, environment, identity. So identity for me is very important here because of many reasons, especially the populations of India which are called as the tribal population. Some of the states are more than 51% of the population is tribal population and their identity is being made inroads into, especially connected to development and sustainable development goal. If you have seen the Nyamgiri Hills case video, anybody who has seen the Nyamgiri, anybody knows about Nyamgiri Hills case? The Vedanta, Pokso. Both of them had an agreement to establish the bauxite mining activities there as part of their enterprise, which has its headquarters in Mumbai. And the tribals who were living in that area, the Dongri tribe, they considered this hill as God. So they personified the hill as God. Personification of the hill as God is part of their identity because they think that they are all the children of that mountain. So for them, it is not just a hill. It's not just a resource. It is part of their identity. It is part of their self-definition. So it has got a deeper ramification for identity. So this famous case of Yamgiri Hills resulted in prevention of the mining. Where earlier the High Court had ignored the panchayat finding because in the panchayat majority members were tribals, that it should not be mined because it has got a cultural significance for them. They consider it as a sacred being. They consider Yamgiri as Yamgiri Raja, a human being, you know, yeah, who is a godly being, who is their creator and sustainer and protector. So that kind of faith system being connected to the environmental regeneration and conservation and connected to their persona and thereby mining being prevented is a great innovation, judicial innovation and recognition of a certain mode of thinking. So the vulnerable have been empowered by their identity being recognized. We have many other ways of identity being recognized. For example, that community was advised to leave that place and send their children to the modern schools which this factory was going to provide for, the company was going to provide for, and these children were supposed to eat the meal which was prepared, midday meal. These were for generations not used to processed food. They were supposed to use as it is occurring in nature in their own way of refinement of the food. So those sensitive dimensions which are also having an implication for their right to survival, their right to have life of their choice, etc., are embedded within the right to identity. Another interesting right to identity conflict in the compounded case of inequality seen in the Shabarimala case. One's right to have a communion with God being differently defined based on the gender. And then the idea of classification and reasoning classification, which was discussed in the case. And the only judge who had the courage and the sensitivity to identify it as a cloaked or kid glove kind of case of untouchability. This is a form of untouchability. It's a very strong phrase used, but comes from a very deep understanding of gendered vulnerability. So that's second we see in right to privacy judgment, the way the Supreme Court elaborated on what this privacy dimension has got implications for as part of right to life. They did not spare cases of culture, cases of gender, cases of children. So the very elaboration of right to privacy is a very good elaboration of vulnerable, the rights of the vulnerable being viewed from a prison. We have in Vishapa case, Justice Verma dwelling deeply on the idea of hostility. I don't know how many of you have seen, that is the crux of the judgment. Hostile environment. It is not just discrimination, it's hostile as well. An environment where she feels unwanted, where she feels opposed. So because of that, sometimes she may be harassed because she is continuing to work, or she may be indirectly made to leave the job by creating such hostility. That, for me, that is the crux of the judgment, the hostility, the hostile environment. Fortunately, Posha Act has captured that part as well, environment of hostility. But I will take it further. Debarbaro, this scholar from Stanford, has prepared a report for the American Bar Association on women in legal profession. And she also wrote an article on subtle sexism, where sexism is not obvious but subtle. For example, you appoint women, but you don't appoint fat women. Or once the women gain weight, you say that you don't be in this position, but you go to this position. Does that ring a bell? Nargesh is the case. After certain years, they don't look very attractive to the customers in the air India, as a cabin crew. So they'll be shifted as ground staff or non-executive clerical position or official position in the office because they are of the childbearing age and things like that. And their childbearing, marriage and childbearing being restricted to to an upper age, which the court found is good because court thought that it was serving the larger purpose. But what the court forgot, that's subtle sexism. What the court forgot is, why only women's body is controlled if the population has to be controlled? So, this we call as body politics, you know, in the feminist language. So, these are the subtle sexism which we can see in the legal parlance, in the judicial discourses, in the legislative provisions. So, Deborah Broad takes the case of fashion, for example, fashion market, and how the whole fashion market expects women to fit into certain type, body type. You know, there was a whole lot of feminist, rather militant feminist attack on Kareena Kapoor for her zero size body. Because it sends a very wrong signal. And in France, they have passed a legislation that skinny fashion icons should not be televised. Because they have seen it as a national nation's disaster, where children have gone off food, off meals, resulting in what you call as bulimia, or you know, they eat and they vomit so that they don't gain weight. So these kinds of health disasters. So subtle sexism is about that within the certain sex or group of people, populating and popularizing certain types of images or preferences. See, between the male and female, you had male preference. Now, within the female, you had preference for those females who, in male gaze, passed off as beautiful, or passed off as wanted, passed off as young. So, youth is worshipped, slim body is worshipped, particular body color is worshipped, skin color is worshipped, particular types of facial features, for example, in fashion industry. You are supposed to have very symmetric cheekbones, and you are supposed to have certain type of distance between your chin and the, having deeply gone into, as feminists have studied these kinds of things, the beauty codes, you know. These beauty codes are utter nonsense. I mean, you cannot have a face, even our Kannada poets have written that lips which are like the, like what, the pomegranate, you know, and the teeth which are like the seeds of the pomegranate. I mean, imagine, the seeds of pomegranate are not always colorless. What about the hybridizing? Or genetically engineered pomegranate, you know, which kind of pomegranate are you comparing? So, all of those who compete in the national beauty pageant undergo plastic surgery to have those voluptuous lips. And I mean, I should have really, under any circumstances, our smile is fixed, you know, so plastic. I mean, there's no smile which shows different kind of excitement or emotion, one type of smile. Why? Because it is structured that way. So, surgical interventions to fit into those beauty needs. So, I am going deeper into these dimensions than where Professor Rukke left to show you how state, market and the male gaze through these agencies. We forget, we always say that it is men. It is not men biologically and physically as people who are problematic. It is a thought process which is problematic, because a man who doesn't fit into a macho definition also gets rejected in this kind of thought process. So vulnerability comes from not matching into the dominant thought process, dominant, accepted stereotypes. So anybody who is different is also becoming vulnerable to discrimination, denial and exploitation. So men who are more into womanly characteristics of caring, not being violent, soft-spoken, also may face such discrimination. They may say that this person is very good, very nice, but not a personality to be the CEO of a company, because he's not aggressive, he's not macho. So they also suffer because of the stereotype. So I am trying to bring those sociocultural dimensions into the idiom of law to show how the discrimination occurs not only in obvious fashion, but also in subtle fashion. So Deborah Rock's theory gives case studies of obese women who have been fired out of job without the scientific consideration that at the age of 39, the whole hormonal changes begin in female body. And very few women are able to cross the threshold of thyroid dysfunction or, cholesterol in the body. So without those health criteria, these women have been labeled as not so presentable, not so marketable, you know. So they are removed from there, they are put in an invisible role. So this is sexism. This is a sexism which is subtle. About the skin color. We Indians, the dominant face in our Bollywood, Hollywood, Tollywood is Italian face. It's an not Indian face, very Italian looking. I mean, I remember George Orwell, my friend from Harvard. He came and said, what is this? You are having all Italians in your Hindi film industry. So, or if they don't look Italian, they look Dravidian, they make them look Italian, you know, with the makeup and the lens or the camera, or nowadays with the software treatment. So, this is where we see the problematic of vulnerability, despite Article 21 protecting it, when it translates into real life. Similarly, we have had legislations, a number of legislations, but we don't have a wherewithal to treat all forms of vulnerability within the legislation. So your generation will have to make cases, public interest litigations, on vulnerability. I also recommend at the end that we have to amend Article 15 clause 3. So that is one. Then judicial innovation has been there. We have seen that solution specific. Looking at the plight of the vulnerable, judiciary has devised a solution. And one of the, I mean, we have seen Muttamma's case where for the first time women's participation in the foreign service being excluded due to marriage was modified. Justice Krishna said, in this day and age, how can one think like how it applies? Similarly, now with the Johar case, highlighted how sexual minority need to be protected by decriminalization of different forms of sex. So this is these cases also highlight the case of one's privacy, one's autonomy, and one's entitlement to the constitutional guarantees of fundamental right. So the vulnerability because of being different is something that was innovated in terms of solution by the judiciary. I'm just highlighting some of it. So if you look at the case of women and children, and if we are looking at the reality, the best interest of the child has been highlighted in most of the legislations. I mean, even in case of custodial battle, or in case of child in conflict with the law, or in case of occasions where children are destitute, etc. So we have to look at what benefit accrues to the child and minimize the harm, zero harm actually, not minimize, zero harm. So safety and the well-being of the child are in the core when we talk about the best interest of the child. So whenever we are making children participate in law reform, or whenever we are making children participate in litigation, we are doing a research on the children, or in our case, when we are doing a research on a child as a case study in our legal research, we are looking at reporting in terms of protecting confidentiality and anonymity, but we also look at the data that children bring to the table. For example, in Uganda research, they were doing it on poverty. They wanted to know what kind of meals they eat, how many meals do they eat, what is the extent of poverty which is affecting the childhood of children. But they realized that one of the children said that his mother did not cook the meal because the father beat the mother. So the child brought that data to the table, that domestic violence is also one of the factors which prevents well-being of the child and attention to the child. So this is where vulnerability as a dimension needs to be seen from the criminal law part of view as well, from the family law part of view as well. So the constitutionality, within the constitutional scheme, when we are looking at it, we are not just looking at the deliberations in the court in terms of that particular case which comes before the court, but a provision which will facilitate law reform and law amendment as well, and expansion of the phrases of the law. There is a duty in the legislator, in the judges, and also in the researchers like us to prevent the harm and suffering to the child, and complementary services to be made available. So what I suggest is Article 15 clause 3 should be not only special provisions to be made for women and children, extended testing and the vulnerable. And the vulnerable will go back to my first slide. I'll bring back that vulnerable because of resources, vulnerable because of location, vulnerable because of time, vulnerable because of unequal power, vulnerable because of transitions in different settings. So who may need special care or support because of the risk of abuse or neglect, who may face distress in comparison to the majority, they are the vulnerable. So this is all I have got to submit to you. If you have specific questions, you are welcome to ask or comment that you want to make. You are welcome to interject. Right? We have half an hour. You all are in the final year, right? And senior classes. How many are PhD students? Have you read about the vulnerability test? First time you are hearing the word, right? We have a university having a dedicated research project on the vulnerable. I told you, Martha Franklin was the chair of the center. Martha Franklin is another prize. She does a lecture, she writes. Anyway, she goes with the bus and she never gets out of the medical because of the hatred for the flight. She's another Greta
Thunberg.
So, Martha said this whole idea of vulnerability into a solid research project. Before that, we spoke about vulnerability in a beastly manner. She consolidated it into a theory, and that theory was picked up by a European Board of Human Rights. We did a research on the sex workers in Karnataka while talking about the reforms. Latest report mentioned this. So our study was not based on risk that sex workers cause, because if you look at Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, it looks at the entire data coming in over Professor Shivali from Manitoba University, focusing more on the risk that is these women form. And the articles are about quantum use and the reduction of HIV, quantum use and the reduction of this, reduction of that. But we focused on vulnerability. What makes these women or girls enter into this sex work? And why they don't give up? What prevents them from leaving it, even though it is a very inhuman kind of work? What kind of preventive measures have to be taken on preventing the vulnerability of certain location? I told you, the theory neatly fits into that. The location is 80% of the sex workers work in Bangalore, in Karnataka, and more than 70% of them come from only four districts which are bordering with Maharashtra and Hyderabad. So, can there be a worse or a better example of vulnerability being a space and time and location issue? And nobody came voluntarily to Bangalore, those who got into long-term sex work. They were either abducted, or they were cheated, or there was a racket which kept transferring them according to the customer, the client wish. So that's a good case study. So second case could be aging population, the way in which their properties are taken out, the way in which their care is not given, and they are institutions, they are put into these old age homes, and lack of responsibility on the part of their family. Similarly, recently you would have seen public interest litigation files about the way in which the halfway homes for women are run, homes for mentally differently abled children is run, and young girls were young girls were sterilized without their consent because they said what consent they can give, they are not well. And this young girl, we studied a case from Punjab. One of our friend lawyers filed litigation, and then the lady was arrested. She used to make it accessible to antisocial elements to abuse these girls. So one of the young girls was pregnant, and she was forced to abort, and then she was sterilized also. This young girl, when the social workers entered there to talk to them, she was holding a doll and she was playing with the doll. Because even though she was limited in terms of her intelligence to interact with the world, her emotional sense was very clear about the motherhood. So this is what the social worker research indicated. So it has got an issue with the reproductive right of the vulnerable as well. I mean, like every other citizen, even the vulnerable have a right to have a normal life. So vulnerable could also be people who are, due to passage of law, being deprived of normal life, like prisoners. We go and work with women prisoners. We realize, I mean, some of them keep their children with them. We know that there is difficulty that the children face. but a lot of special support has to be given. So the child also becomes a different category of vulnerable there, and the mother is also vulnerable there. So this kind of special attention to these people as vulnerable. And another example is learning disability. I have a whole lot of stories to tell you on learning disability. The way in which the school discriminates between the child who scores and doesn't score, and the child who doesn't score may have an extraordinary capacity in fine arts or sports, which is being totally segregated and undermined, and that damages the child for life. And the state doesn't have a mechanism by which these schools are audited, doesn't have a mechanism of intervention. Sometimes NGOs do, parental organizations do, but even the parents are not very well educated. I mean, you have the classic Tarasavin movie, which shows the mother's unconditional love and the father's expectation of the child. So this is where the social reality and the constitutional scheme need to be looking at recent trends. So I'm saying, what is the recent trend that is required in the constitution? I'm not just saying, how is the constitution operating? How it is useful? I'm talking about the art. I'm more of a natural law school from the international law background. I'm more of a natural law school person. What ought to be done? And that ought doesn't come from the top of the head or abstract philosophy. It comes from the reality of life and the possibility we have seen in other states. Did we create a constitution with the genome of best practices? We hybridized from the best practices of other countries. So can't we have those best practices guiding us in reinventing the constitution, especially making it work better for the vulnerable? Right? And then you put a clause within that vulnerable history and you say, it may include, and not limited to, it may include inter alia. So already this has been identified in some basic research by political scientists and others, but we need to have legal researchers focusing more on this. Yeah, please.
I have a question. There are certain situations in which law deprives people of certain rights, so making certain portion of society, so the section of people vulnerable. So what is firstly your opinion on that? And secondly, shouldn't there be recognition of such people wherein law itself by the virtue of its existence makes somebody or a portion of society vulnerable? Say women, for example. Firstly, now there is law that states that we need to see the mental state of a child when he's committing a crime in order to try him in juvenile court or otherwise. So whether that the law itself makes that individual to 16 years of age vulnerable, so should that be considered as an important?
Yes, yes, yes. A child physical, that is what Martha Feynman said. Physical, the overemphasis on the physical is wrong. I mean, it's not the right approach. I'm not saying wrong, but it's not the adequate approach. Solely the mental element, the mental health, mental disability. These things are entering into the mainstream law. Earlier it was a stigma. You know how the mental hospitals evolved? In the beginning, mental hospitals were located near the prisons. In Erwada, in our Pune, mental hospital and prison are opposite each other. So mentally ill were considered like the prisoners, outcast. And they were chained. So we had very bad situations. Right from the British who imposed this on us. So I do agree on that. But it would need, see, this is where interdisciplinary studies are required. It would need more and more case studies and statistics to come. And then to create a formulation of the law on the policy guidelines on how to address such issues. So you can't look at the juvenile just by age. Gopal Subramanian, in one of the discussions when they excluded that juvenile in the Nirbhaya case, there were vehement, in the NDTV discussion, there was vehement opposition. Then he said, tell me where this person comes from. Does he come from some other society? The person comes from our own society. So we owe a responsibility. If that child is committing that kind of crime, who is underage person, who is committing that kind of crime, isn't the society role? See, our concession, you must understand. There is this famous work by Michel Foucault, who is a postmodernist philosopher.
He talks about Armenians in trilogy. One of them is Birth of a Prison and Crime and Punishment. In both these, he argues how demonization of certain people results in unfair treatment, you know. Like, for example, he says, punishment got refined as the civilization evolved. It did not refine because somebody did research and somebody devised refined ways of punishment. It refined because civilization evolved and it did not feel good about those laws of punishment. So when we are asking this juvenile to be treated at par with adults and to be subject to the same amount of punishment, does your civilization and your knowledge, scientific knowledge, permit? That's the question. So, in approaching the whole justice issue, the case of the different, the case of vulnerable, the case of the demon, you consume charas, you are demonized. But you have a whole lot of alcohol, it's customary. Even the rich people drink in clubs every day. So if you are looking at on the neutral pedestal of health, then it is more of addiction happens out of certain nerve circuits in the brain. Research has proved that. Addiction is a form of mental defilement. You know that? Everyone doesn't become addict until you taste your first pint of first peg of alcohol. You may not know that you are likely to be an alcoholic. And everybody is not alcoholic. So there is a health dimension, there is a medical dimension, there is a certain vulnerability in the individual. So we don't exclude such vulnerability. Therefore, we don't demonize those who consume drugs, those who consume alcohol, those who have such anxieties. We consider them as part of this society, part of this legal system. But I go one step further from Dr. Murthy, who said that, who was quoting about sameness, no sameness at all. I say same but treated differently because of the uniqueness. And I also say historically neglected, therefore given special opportunity. So this is what equality clauses in the constitution. Maternity benefit because she is different. She is sacrificing her body to bear the child for the sake of. So you can't grow that child in until artificial womb is created. So she is giving up her 9 months of health and everything, youth, to carry this life, and the life is not for her alone. That's going to make a difference to the community, to the state, to the family. Therefore, you need to compensate us. That's how maternity benefit act came. But we were only happy in giving that. Did we give her the tax benefits? Okay. Did we give her the tax benefit when she is the caregiver? When the rest of the members of the family are going for public domain to work, that tax benefit can flow to her as her capital. The idea of unwed mother having maternity leave, maternity benefit, child care leave. Again, marriage becomes the basis. Like our body became the basis of mother.
Yeah, surrogacy will come.
Yeah,
surrogacy. It's exactly no mention of a widow, there is no mention of a divorce. They have totally segregated that. They should, well, I think the basic token of the constitution. Then itself, according to that, like, it cannot be amended. Certain features of the constitution cannot be amended. Or do you really believe in the basic doctrine? Do you have seen the basic doctrine of the constitution of India?
See, the thing is, the constitution is somewhere here.
Yes.
And society is somewhere here. But constitution was a social document. Ambedkar brought so much of reality into the constitution. The reality of the vulnerable. Ambedkar was the voice of the vulnerable. He spoke about women, he spoke about the Dalits, he spoke about the excluded,
reservation.
Yeah,
the whole thing.
And he did both, you know, the preventive, facilitative, and proactive, all three, in terms of addressing the vulnerability, without using the word vulnerable. But the limitation of those times was what was more pestering in those days took too much of importance. After that, we did not have an advocate for the vulnerable because that got divided into majority vote and politics. For Ambedkar, that was not important. It was related to the idea of justice and he himself had the pain area of vulnerability. So we did not have such authentic politician or authentic statesman. I would use the word statesperson coming and advocating their cause.
Do you feel that? I mean, we had a few women like Indira Jaisingh and others and who made a difference to Vishaka, who threw the Vishaka case, she and her sister. So we had very few though. I mean, command of women in law or people from the vulnerable section in law and then listening to that and incorporating it into the legal vocabulary was not easy. So slowly it's coming, but then again it is lost in the majority. So what is not majority is online. So today you are talking about these recent amendments and things like that. Apply the vulnerability thesis, then you will see the truth. Don't go by what Congress says. Don't go by what BJP says. As a law researcher, you look at the power. Who has the real power? And who is the powerless? And how far? If not that powerless is not heard. People from northeastern states tell me that what is happening is right. But a segment in the northeastern population feels that the way it is handled is not right. Because new vulnerable segments are created in terms of that. So, vulnerable is Gandhi's antyodaya. When the talisman. So, what difference does it make to that person, Daridra Nara? And here the idea is not just lack of wealth, it is lack of power. So that is how we need to conceive this. I hope it is very convincing for you and a new dimension that I opened up. It will take some time to sink in. We have been reading this for years, so I mean, I'm always passionate about making the law work for the man. How many people? It may be in the microcosm of a college, or in a village, or in a police station. Through an NGO, and it can be the macrocosm of the province or the state. In all, the running thread is constitutionality and the constitutional guarantees which are given to the individual. Today, the further vulnerability, see how vulnerability is a relative rating as well. How much of a rich you are. Have you read about this episode of Infosys founder being hauled up in Bulgaria when he was a young NGO? He had to undergo 7 days of imprisonment by the railway police for no fault of his. And then they release him because some officer finds out that he is Indian, and then in India and Bulgaria are friends. You know, Bulgarian Prime Minister's daughter is a Hindi scholar. She took her Sanskrit professor from India and created a new philology chair in Bulgaria. This was the day of internship in Bulgaria. But it was in Bulgaria that he was arrested. So you become vulnerable where you are not politically a citizen. So vulnerability is not necessarily about money, power or anything. Even legal vulnerability is. Okay. Second case of vulnerability is the vulnerability of the people in unfamiliar situations. You know, young women being vulnerable in certain ways, even older people becoming vulnerable in certain ways, senior citizens. That is why we have a broad criterion of vulnerability. Yeah.
I'm going to say, this vulnerability, when we classify it, it's about the legal sections. But don't you think we already have laws regarding the
privilege? That is why I addressed this. You would ask this question.
Why should we include it in this section?
Because the legal section definition was drawn up long, long ago. It did not capture the transition which have happened in science and technology, in human understanding, in philosophical modernism, and the new formations of society, I told you. Today we are not talking about within nation kind of classes, transnational capital classes, transnational oppressive classes. Oppression in India, oppression in the Nike factory in Thailand, or Amazon in the US, same. So we are discovering the common gene. We are at that level. So reading into constitution, the internationalization environment, the post-globalization is very important when we are looking at constitution, and I am seeing it through the lens of vulnerability. Because for me, that is the one which links the SDG with the decolonization movement of general assembly in the 1950s, permanent sovereignty over resources. For me, that is the magnitude and the time span. Any other questions?
So, ma'am, I believe that whenever you talk about vulnerability, wouldn't it be much more feasible to debate about each of those vulnerable spaces problems separately than considering them as a whole?
Conceptualization is on the whole.
Yes, ma'am.
But strategizing is different. For example, if you ask me on how to research on a child soldier, is very different from how to research on a child in custody or how to research on a child who is alienated from the parent who is not custodial parent. Three different methodologies. But the concern is the same, that they are the ones who are possibly being exploited, who are ignored, who is not experiencing the situation like the majority, therefore uniquely you treat. That's all it is. Today we are trying to see the rhetoric, the concept, in the constitutional context, because constitution anyway is a public law. It is a general framework. Specificity flows through legislations, guidelines and policy. Ministerial. Many kinds of what we call as hypnotism, black magic. Second could be that women's body at that time exudes very strong pheromones because of nature's draw to create new life. So maybe at that time they would have been vulnerable to men who traveled with them, also would have been vulnerable to the animals and things. Because Shashikala was in the biggest part of those just to start something that he'd be in forest, which is supposed to be mainly biodiversity rich. That could be very simple. Or the Brahmachari god being held as somebody who doesn't look at any woman from that desire and so it's a really a separate connotation for the male as well, not only in something. But eventually when it became problematic was such forest threat was not there, proper roads were created, access was created, and then openly talking about menstruating women as excluded. They would have said women of this age group are excluded. And they would have explained the reason. But when the commissioner, woman commissioner goes to the refurbishment activity of the temple, she is being excluded because she is of that age group. That is because authority neutralizes you, technology neutralizes you. But there also when they are carrying it by saying that the temple priest got a dream and in the dream Lord was unhappy, that is the Krishna Madhavan they found out. Why Lord was unhappy? Because this woman was frequenting the temple for refurbishment. That is the first time Shabarimala Devas case came. Recently it was reopened. We have been discussing this case. Ratna Kapoor and I were on the same family in National Hospital in 90s. Cases came there. They were same old. Transferred the case.
92
onwards. Yeah, 92 onwards that we were present.
And Ayurved he himself was vulnerable to his stepmother's case. So it could be that he was catapulted. She was made to go to forensics and all that.
Yeah, stepmother's ill treatment was there. But still he brings in the tiger's skin, his compassion towards the stepmother. I mean, for me, Ayappa is a god who has never been discriminating. I mean, he hails as the utmost example of respect for women.
Yeah.
Yeah. Whereas this is what we have problems with. In any religion, scripture and this one have got enough meaning for empowerment of women. There is one scholar in this All Women's College in NFKRE. She has written about how even in Manusmriti, there are so many areas where it is truly resonating empowerment of women. But the selective interpretation at some point of time by some interpreters would be so negative to women. So you should not reject any ritual by its inherent wording. Over a period of time, how people who were in power interpreted it for their own advantage or simply by blind faith. Without moving with the times. You know, once upon a time there was no way one could control the menstruation. And there was no way one could reach Shabarimala within 24 hours because it was very, very inaccessible kind of things.
Yeah, the tigers, the pediatrics.
Yeah, tigerism. And all of that. Whereas today it is not.
Tigers can catch the scent, so basically catch the lady.
Scent and women's body has a very strong pheromones. So, eventually when all these things are overcome, see, I'll give you the example, my mother's generation, when they attend puberty, next day school cut, no way they can continue in the school, you talk to your grandmother. So many bright women who taught the school till 7th standard, they had topic examination in those days, could not continue in that school. Suddenly, abruptly their education would end and they would just follow the suit because that was the way their mother was treated. That was what was told to them. You go well in the school, but whatever you do, finally you have to wash vessels and put them in. This is how our identity was told to them. But some parents who could afford, who were aware, both see resources, money as well as awareness, they took their daughters to all women schools and put them in the boarding and continued their education. They excel as doctors, as professors, but only handful. And then came the next generation when these educated women published their stories and then there were all women universities created and then it was safe for girls to get out and do and there the women mentored women and told them about the physical changes and how to overcome them and the medicalization. I think the whole usage of medical devices to overcome the menstruation inconveniences have played a key role in women's external engagement, public engagement, whether it is education or employment. Would you see that? Definitely. Because my mother used to say that her classmate who got puberty in the school going time of the day, because everybody reacts differently, she was rushed from the school to the home, and then next day, after a few days, she was brought back to school. And if any girl in that class was absent for 3 or 4 days, the boys would tease her. And then next month, if there was stain seen in the skirt and things like that, these girls used to feel as if they were physically dead. It was such an embarrassment. So they would undergo psychological trauma, depression, because of the social stigma and social shame. Because boys would ask questions, why, what is this? Because they wouldn't have their innocence, you know, because boys mature much later and they wouldn't know. There was no sex education in the schools. Now we have in the curriculum sex education, the changes that body goes through and things like that. Parents even today won't discuss it with children. Because this is cultural, social stigma about it. But now there are new media, social media, and schools take initiative. So that awareness and not to feel bad about the changes that one goes through in the body. So there's a larger dimension to this. So for me, Shabarimala case is a kind of case in point in terms of discussing large issues. That's why you would see the Padman coming at the same time. See how it creates ripples over the world. Very good. That's why we said, I mean, here I just brought one hypothesis for representation, and also when you are doing research, for example, about children or any vulnerable class, never ignore the data they bring. The Uganda case I gave you as a basic point. Like child workers when you interview, you see their condition, you know how they are. But suddenly the child worker may reveal some truth to you and may reveal some desire to you. So quote them in their own language and don't forget to put them in your recommendation in their own language. So this is why they are no more the objects of research, they are subjects of research. And they are the data providers and they are the data owners. Therefore the outcome of your research also has to be communicated. And that doesn't exclude constitutional amendment or law. Any others? So I think we are on time. Yeah. How the time? Thank you very much.
Thank you.